Hi everyone, and welcome to today's virtual tech talk hosted by Mindtree entitled Bluetooth Low Energy Audio versus Classic. I'm your host, Sarah Jeckman. In case you're not familiar with Mindtree, we're a $1.1 billion digital consulting and IT services firm that provides technology solutions to over 12 industries. Our 22,000 Mindtree minds work across 18 countries, helping to deliver innovative and impactful technology and digital solutions to over 300 customers. So a few housekeeping notes to get us started. You are currently in listen-only mode. If you experience any technical difficulties during the webinar, click on Help or send us a chat in the webinar console. I'd also like to mention that today's presentation will be recorded and available for future playback. We'll also be conducting a few polls during the webinar and would love your participation. All poll selections are anonymous, and you may see the results pop up in our future marketing initiatives. This is an interactive session, so feel free to type your questions into the question box located on your console, and we'll do our best to answer as many questions as we can at the end of the session. And lastly, we'd love to hear from you on social, so feel free to tweet us at Mindtree_LTD or use the hashtag Bluetooth with Mindtree. We've got a great program lined up for you today, and to start, I'd like to introduce you to our experts. From Mindtree, we have Rajanikanth Mohan, Product Manager for Short Range Wireless, and Anindya Bakshi, Chief Architect for Short Range Wireless. We're also pleased to be joined by Chuck Sabin, Senior Director of Market Development at Bluetooth SIG. And now I'd like to turn it over to Rajanikanth to get us started.
Thank you, Sarah. Let me start off by introducing myself. So I spent about 18 years in the semiconductor industry, starting off as a circuit designer. Spent quite a bit of time at Cypress in the product management function. And over the last 5 years, I've been with Mindtree, building Bluetooth solutions, primarily on the software-related, audio-related applications, targeting both semiconductor companies and OEMs. So getting into why Mindtree is actually here, making this talk about Bluetooth. So as many of you may already know, Mindtree is a leader in Bluetooth IP and engineering services. We had quite a few leading semiconductor companies and OEMs who have gone to market based on our IP, or we have helped them go to market through our engineering services. So most of the leading chipset companies you see in the world actually incorporate the Mindtree's Bluetooth IP underneath. So being an IP provider, we actually get to see, we get an early peek at how the technology is evolving. And we get to work with our customers at very early stages in their product development cycle. And so we often get to hear a lot of questions from them on, especially related to the 5.2 and audio or Bluetooth low energy and TWS. So the objective of this webinar here is we're trying to answer the questions which we provide to our customers, to you, and hopefully we can answer some of the queries in your mind. So the agenda for today, at the end of 60 minutes, you will have an understanding of, or at least an introduction to Bluetooth Low Energy, and how it enables audio over Bluetooth Low Energy, from basically how 5.2 is enabling audio over Low Energy. And since a lot of us have some experience with audio in the classic domain, we compare the features and the throughput, et cetera, and the power from a classic and low energy perspective. And we also get into the true wireless domain. Right here, although the technology is true wireless for classic is still new in the market. There are a lot of companies still building solutions for that. And so we spent some time on looking at how is true wireless achieved on the classic Bluetooth side, as well as on the low energy side. But before we get into the technical piece, I think we need to really have an understanding of how big this phenomenon of Bluetooth over low energy is going to be, and opportunity we are really trying to address with this webinar. And for that, we have Chuck on the call. So I'm going to pass it on to him. Chuck, over to you.
All right, well, thank you very much, Rajan. Again, my name is Chuck Sabin. I'm the Senior Director for Market Development at the Bluetooth SIG. And what that really means is I spend a lot of my time looking at future market opportunity for the technology and what are the requirements that are necessary in the market for the technology to be a success on behalf of all the companies that use it. So many of you may be familiar with the Bluetooth Special Interest Group. We are the organization at the heart of the Bluetooth technology. We help service industry-leading companies like Mindtree around the globe in effectively three critical areas. The first is around specification process and the development of new features and providing the opportunities for companies to come together to be able to build new functions and features and capabilities into the specification. Second, as an organization, we provide the test tools and the qualification process to drive interoperability between devices in the market. And third, we provide the promotion of the Bluetooth brand to help open up new market opportunities for our members. The Bluetooth Special Interest Group is based in Kirkland, Washington. We operate as a not-for-profit trade association with over 35,000 member companies working to help advance Bluetooth technology in a variety of markets and solutions. So next slide. And what is apparent is how the efforts of the Bluetooth community actually directly impact the commercial success of the technology. Annual shipments of Bluetooth technology and products that use Bluetooth will continue to grow at an incredible rate. This year alone, it's expected that 4.6 billion Bluetooth-enabled devices will ship this year alone, continuing a strong growth potential for the technology. And for the first time in our forecasts, Bluetooth devices shipping each and every year will exceed 6 billion devices each year by 2024. Now, the interesting fact about what's happening with Bluetooth is that what you see in this green line is the percentage of what we would consider non-phone, tablet, and PC shipments. And so many of you may know Bluetooth for being on your mobile phone, but whereas in 2015, only 33% of all devices shipped were of the non-phone type, meaning peripherals and accessories and other things, by 2024, that percentage will completely shift or flip. By 2024, two-thirds of all Bluetooth shipments will be in the non-phone tablet PC device categories. These are wearables, audio devices, speakers, sensors, other devices utilizing Bluetooth technology in order to enable new device types and new use cases. And what this is really highlighting is the diversity and the continued diversity that we see out of Bluetooth over time. And it really makes Bluetooth one of the most successful technologies in the world without any real signs of it slowing down at this point. So next slide. So how does Bluetooth ultimately achieve this growth? Well, Bluetooth achieves this success by being a solutions-oriented technology. Bluetooth is really driving four waves of solution innovation in the market: audio streaming, data transfer, location services, and device networks. And each of these solution areas have a unique value for developers and allow for sort of significant solutions in the market, making Bluetooth the number one embedded wireless technology for IoT devices worldwide. And each of these solution areas in the vertical markets, they're discussed in more detail in what we have is a Bluetooth market update, our 2020 Bluetooth market update. So if you're interested in the significant details behind each one of these solution areas and the markets that they support, I encourage you to download that market update and forecasts from Bluetooth.com. Because each of these solution areas give developers a full stack, fit for purpose set of solutions aimed at delivering flexible and addressing very specific connectivity needs. But today we're here to really talk about the future of audio streaming. And so next slide. So for those of you that aren't aware, audio is actually the number one solution area for Bluetooth. Now, by 2024, there will be over 1.5 billion Bluetooth audio streaming devices shipping each and every year. Now, these numbers have continued to be revised up, and I'm always surprised to see how fast the forecasts actually continue to increase year over year. And what it's really doing is picking up on the accelerated demand that's happening in the market for things like portable speakers, smart speakers, and wireless earbuds as well. And that's what you see in this red line. If you look at the 2019 forecast for audio streaming, the numbers for 2020 have continued to be revised up even from previous year's shipment forecasts. Now, mind you, this does not include things like platform devices like phones, tablets, and PCs. This forecast of 1.5 billion by 2024 is about audio peripherals and audio sync devices, headsets, speakers, car kits, and so forth. Anything that's using audio and the audio functionality of Bluetooth in order to create and develop an audio streaming capability for the consumer. So next slide. So as I noted, compared to last year, the forecasts have ultimately been streaming up or have been continuing to be revised up. But just a little insight as to what goes behind those numbers that we see in the forecast. 97% of all speakers that are forecasted to ship by 2024 are going to include Bluetooth. So speakers themselves are becoming a wireless technology as a complete solution. And with well over 600 to 700 million wireless headsets sold each year, 38% of those headsets are forecasted to be truly wireless earbuds by 2024. Now, TWS as a trend has ultimately been very amazing for Bluetooth and for consumers, and that the earbuds have clearly and quickly become the form factor of choice for most consumers in the market. And while it's not reflected in the current forecasts, the introduction of LE audio will ultimately open up new opportunities with new form factors like hearing aids and new use cases like audio sharing capabilities for broadcasting and sharing information or sharing audio amongst broad audiences. And so next slide. Because earlier this year, we announced the roadmap for the LE audio specification. And there's no doubt that audio is very important to the Bluetooth SIG community, including Mindtree. And we are very excited about the future that audio is going to bring for Bluetooth. And LE audio is ultimately creating new energy for our suppliers and for the market, developing new form factors and new use cases to ultimately continue to increase that overall penetration of wireless audio in the market. And so we see LE audio as an opportunity to continue to accelerate the growth that we're already seeing in the market with classic audio and see greater user adoption of wireless audio into their daily life. And quite frankly, we ultimately see LE audio potentially changing the way that people engage with each other and the environment around them by using some of the audio sharing capabilities and the broadcast capabilities that are coming forward in the specification for the future. But for the remainder of this webinar, Mindtree will highlight many of the new features and the use cases. I'm not going to talk about those in detail. I'll let Mindtree take over and speak to those new features and those use cases coming together for LE audio to help continue to flourish this 1.5 billion device market by 2024.
Okay. So we have a poll at this point, try to get an understanding of your experience on the domain of audio, etc. So our objective here is primarily to get a feel of the audience. We want to understand your experience and your expertise in this domain. And that's going to kind of help us guide through the rest of the conversation and to basically figure out how much of a depth we need to get into in terms of the webinar and where do we need to stop. So that's the objective of this poll. Are we seeing the poll results here right now?
It looks like there's the majority of the audience has worked with audio and Bluetooth Classic, but also have been worked with non-audio applications over Bluetooth as well.
Great. Okay, that's good to know.
Yeah.
So I'm going to continue our conversation and pass it on to Anindya. Anindya?
Sure, Rajini. Thank you, Sarah, for the lovely introduction, and Rajini and Chuck for setting up the initial section. Welcome to the Tech Talk on this AD audio. I sincerely hope that you all are doing very well in this globally challenging time. Let me start off with a very brief intro. My name is Anindya Bakshi. I'm the Chief Architect and General Manager for Mindtree Short Range Wireless Group, working with Bluetooth almost for last 19 years, starting from version 1.1 of the Classic specification. Just after the Bluetooth Low Energy was introduced in 2010, I was fortunate to be part of the Bluetooth Architecture Review Board in 2011 and 12 period. Me and my team have co-authored several versions of the core specification, including the last adopted 5.2 specification and many profiles and service club specifications. Now that's about me. Now let's move on to the topic. So in today's discussion, we'll first take a quick look on Bluetooth Classic audio, just to set up the context. And then we'll take a closer look into the Bluetooth Low Energy, the various use cases, the related standards, and what we can expect from this brand new LE audio. Most of us are using audio over Bluetooth in some form or the other, in our wireless headsets, in our car for hands-free calls, or to listen to music on our favorite pair of earbuds. Voice call and the music streaming, as we know, are the two primary use cases. In both of these, apart from transfer of the audio or the music, voice audio or the music, controlling the call like accept or reject, or media streaming to play and pause are also done using Bluetooth wirelessly. If we look from the Bluetooth technology point of view, these use cases are put together as a profile specification. This is to simplify and also at the same time to ensure interoperability. Most of the use cases have two roles, like a client server, source or sync, gateway unit, etc. In typical audio use cases for the classic Bluetooth, one side will be the mobile phone and the other will be the headset. Below is a quick look on the full stack component, which is required, which is used in a classic Bluetooth system. So you have the Bluetooth controller, the HCI, the L2 cap layer, the various protocol layers like for the AV DTP and AVCTP, which is basically for the audio video transmission or for the remote control. And then you have the profiles like A2DP, AVRCP, and HFP. So this is typically the very commonly, and then because the audience here, we see that more than half is quite familiar with that. So let us move to the next slide. Okay. To summarize, for media streaming in classic Bluetooth, A2DP profile is used for transferring the audio over an asynchronous link. And another profile, which is AVRCP, is used for controlling the media pair. For the voice call, setting up the call, call control, all of these are done over hands-free. It uses the synchronous channel to ensure the low latency audio, which is required for, as we understand, for the conversational audio. For music streaming, subband codec is the default audio codec. For the voice, we typically use CVSD, or for a high quality wideband speech, which is like a 16 kilohertz kind of an audio, we use a simplified version, which is called the modified SVC. And that also helps in keeping the latency low. Most of these use cases, as you know, are point to point audio, from phone or music player to the headset and like that. With all the smartphones now supporting Bluetooth, For quite some time now, search for innovative audio use cases continues. For example, to support multicast audio, which stretches the Bluetooth technology to its limit. With the introduction of Apple AirPod, the truly wireless earbuds become mainstream. It is trendy, supports active lifestyle, and truly wireless. These innovative solutions are though tricky. There are many challenges to meet. The user expectation, when the underlying technology does not truly support this use cases, it is cumbersome to implement, and also to have the best performance in terms of the audio quality and the good battery life is really very challenging. Now, as we have seen, the transition from the classic Bluetooth to Bluetooth Low Energy, a decade of learning of the classic Bluetooth was being used in the design of the Bluetooth Low Energy. Keeping the same tradition, it is almost like now two decades of experience of wireless audio in the Bluetooth, the classic Bluetooth, pushing all these boundaries of the classic audio. The Bluetooth Low Energy or the ALE audio is being designed based on all those foundations and all those learnings. So we'll move on to the next slide and take a closer look into the Bluetooth ALE audio. Rajni, next slide, please. Yeah. So what does ALE audio brings to the table? As we mentioned that, okay, it brings a brand new design from a technology consortium with the experience of 20 years in the wireless audio space. A modern codec, simplifying implementation of some of the challenging use cases as we're talking about before, like synchronized multi-streaming, native support for broadcasting, and also bringing in features which helps hearing aids to embrace Bluetooth as the key technology. We'll take a closer look at LC3 in the following slide. ALE by design now supports synchronized multi-streaming and broadcasting audio with the introduction of isochronous channel, which is introduced in the Bluetooth 5.2 specification, which got adopted in the 1st January 2020, the first day of this year. And apart from that, the hearing aids is something which is a little new, although they were using the hearing aid segment is using Bluetooth Classic for some time, but they have some unique scenarios, use cases, and requirements when it is compared with the consumer headsets. Hearing aids have very strict power budget, as we can understand, and also very low latency requirement. It need to get the ambient sound with music and the voice call to ensure the safety of the person using the hearing aid at the public places, on travel, etc. ALE audio has well-designed provisions to support these requirements for the hearing aid, along with supporting the consumer audio. In the next two slides, we'll look into some of the key components which makes this ALE audio possible. Next slide. Yeah. So this in this slide, we talk about the codec LC3. LC3 is capable of providing a very high compression ratio without really compromising perceivable audio quality. Has very low latency, making it possible to use the same codec for both conversational as well as the music streaming scenarios. If we look into the graph on the left side, the y-axis represents the audio quality. Higher the number, better the quality. And x-axis is the bandwidth. Blue bars, what you see, represents LC3, and gray ones are SBC. So you can see that at 160 kilobits per second with LC3, we get slightly better audio quality when it is compared to 345 kbps of SBC. So this 345 kbps of SBC number comes from the A2DP specification, which is for the high quality audio at 48 kilohertz. So it is almost like with the half the bandwidth, we can get the similar quality or better quality audio with LC3. This low bandwidth requirement helps in reducing the overall radio active time without compromising the audio quality. LC3 has a superset, which is known as the LC3 Plus, and this is also adopted as part of the DEC standard, which has a very stringent latency requirement that the low latency codec need to be less than 15 milliseconds. So LC3 also inherits the same thing. So it is very low latency, as we mentioned. And this low latency also helps in realizing many use cases. In some use cases where somebody want to hear the real-time feedback, and then for some learning sessions and various such use cases. And other interesting thing which comes with LC3, like with the A2DP, we had only few sampling frequencies supported, like 8 kilohertz, 16 kilohertz, 44.1 and 48. It also introduces 32 and 24 kilohertz sampling rate, which also has a lot of good use cases. And the other important thing is that, like with the SBC or the older codecs, I would say, or the classic codecs, we will have a mono or the stereo kind of a concept. But with the modern codecs like LC3, it is not restricted to a mono or stereo channel. It basically works on a particular channel. That's how it is defined. So it has no limitation or restriction on the number of channels that can be supporting. The codec can support. So implementing something like a 5.1 speakers and all of them becomes simpler. Apart from the codec, so this is one of the key highlights which you see from the LE audio. But then we'll also look into some of the key features which is present in the last adapted core specification 5.2, which are essential to realize the LE audio. Next slide. Yeah, so if you look into the 5.2 specification, one of the things which is very highlighted, everyone is talking about, is the LE ISOC support to transmit the audio over LE. That's the primary use case. And it supports both connection oriented as well as broadcast audio. So you can broadcast the audio, which was not possible previously with the Bluetooth and classic Bluetooth, and also you can have a connection oriented channel. And now this connection-oriented CIS can be used also in a group and which can be synchronized. So it makes it pretty simple supported by the standards to create this kind of a TW use cases. And this bidirectional audio, it can be configured for different packet sizes, latencies, different kind of retransmit, different kind of a quality of service if we can talk about on both direction. Or somebody can configure it just one direction, like from the phone to the when somebody's streaming music to the earbuds, it will be like one directional, and they can be synchronized. So this is one of the thing which is very, very important. And then also the broadcast audio. So there also it can be grouped, and it has multiple use cases, like silent announcement, let's say in the airports or in the museum, to go and learn about an object of interest with the specific language of choice. And each of these audio pipes can be configured, multiple of them. Some is transmitting music, some voice call, some maybe system notification. Each of us was having a different direction, bidirection, single direction, and then have a different kind of a quality of service. And also this audio data, both the connection oriented and broadcast data, can be secured. So this can be encrypted so that only the desired audience only can access. So this is the one key thing which is basically highlighted on the LE audio part of it. But there are other important changes are also there in the 5.2 specification, which is equally important, I would say, for the LE audio to get realized. So the other important change happened in the attribute protocol. ATT was introduced in the first version of the Bluetooth low energy spec, that is 4.0, and it was one of the key features which helped the wider adoption of Bluetooth low energy by making the low energy modular, like microservices, creating complex use cases, combining many of them possible. For example, we have battery and heart rate as separate services, and one can combine these two to realize a heart rate monitor device. The design concept worked very well so far. One of the limitation though of traditional ATT, it is transaction based protocol. So only one transaction can be pending between a pair of devices. So if multiple applications are using attribute protocol, one have to wait for the other transaction to get complete. But as you can all understand, for the audio use cases, which is more real time, some of the requirements are really real time. So ATT enhancement is introduced with the 5.2 spec to allow creation of multiple ATT channels between a pair of devices. Each of those pipes, so the control pipes, can support multiple different packet sizes and various different configurations. And so multiple applications can create similar pipes based on their requirement, and they do not have to get blocked by the other application. So in the diagram, as we see that if some application is sending a larger packet and then another application is sending a smaller packet, the ATT layer or the L2 cap can configure in such a way that the larger packet get fragmented and the smaller packets can be actually scheduled in between, so that there is no degradation on the performance which is expected from the such use cases. And there are for it is not only the change in the ATT, but also there has been change in the underlying L2 cap layer also done in the part of the specification. So these are some of the key changes required to support ALE audio profile use cases. Now, ALE audio profile specification itself are being ratified at this moment. We will soon start seeing first bunch of ALE audio profiles with the absolute essentials, and then more to follow with the richer set of features. This is going to be an interesting beginning as ALE carries on the legacy of classic Bluetooth audio, complementing and enhancing, making some of the difficult use cases simpler to implement, and all at the same time opening the door for more and more innovations with this state-of-the-art modular design. Mindtree as an organization has all the IP blocks except for the Bluetooth radio, like starting from the LC3 codec, Bluetooth controller, stack, audio SDK. It is going to have an exciting journey with ALE audio. Now I hand it over to Rajni, who will walk us through TWS and ALE audio. Over to you, Rajni.
Yeah, thanks, Ravindra. I think before we jump into TWS, we are going to have another poll. So here again, similar to our first poll, our objective is to understand the audience and try to figure out what your expertise is and also what your interest is. So that's going to help drive the conversation forward. So we're just waiting for the results. Very interesting to see. As we see, the first bucket is getting to almost a 40 to 45% is what we're seeing, where a lot of you have, oh, it's dropping now. So I guess the audience is now kind of split a third across the categories. So that's kind of what we're seeing. So people are new to TWS. About a third of the audience have worked on TWS Classic and are looking to figure out what the next step is with low energy. And some of the audience are starting TWS implementation right now. So it's interesting mix. Okay, so yeah. Let me go on to, I think I missed the slides here. Okay. So coming on to the crux of the interesting topic TWS, right? So what we see with our customers today is two different strategies for implementing TWS. The first is what we call the relay method, and the second is the sniffing method, both of which has its own advantages and disadvantages. So we quickly go through each of these. So as you can see in this picture, the relay method, there is a single connection which goes from the source to one of the earbuds, what we call the primary earbud. And then there's a secondary connection which goes from the primary to the secondary earbud. And there's often also a Bluetooth black channel to enable the synchronization. The advantage is that it is actually possible to implement TWS in the relay method without customizations, although we, in the subsequent slides, we will get into a few of these as well. The negative is obviously that the power consumption is going to be higher compared to other methods because you have multiple connections being handled by one of the earbuds. If you come to the sniffing mode, here there's a single connection from the source to one of the earbuds, and the second earbud is actually sniffing the packets of the first connection. The key advantage is obviously power connection, power conservation because of a single connection we have here. But there are two major constraints. One is that most of the chipsets you see in the market today actually don't support sniffing mode. So I wouldn't be surprised if an OEM is unable to find any chipset in the market today which supports sniffing for them to incorporate into their design. So that's a problem. And the second is obviously the patents. So we are all aware of a few key, very large OEMs who have kind of locked up the patents on the space and restricting the usage of the sniffing mode. But we do have customers who have taken both these approaches when they're confident enough with respect to the patents. Let's look at what kind of customizations are required. So the first, to get the sniffing mode out of the way, the connection between the left and the right would be applicable for both the sniffing mode as well as the relay mode approaches. And enabling sniffing itself is a pretty big customization. So that aside, right, what we are going to, what we will see is pretty much what our customers seem to be adopting is that we have a proprietary accelerated connection between the left and the right earbuds. So it's something like a power on auto connect, which is completely transparent to the end customer, so that it is very quick and does not, this is effectively, this connection is proprietary and accelerated. And that's one level of customization. The second level of customization is called role switching. So when you say role switching, we just talked about how one of the headsets would be the primary headset and would consume a lot of power compared to the other headset. So we have seen a lot of customized implementations where you have seamless real-time switching of these roles from primary to secondary. And this also is going to be very important for the purpose of power conservation. And this is actually required for the sniffing mode as well, because you, even in the sniffing mode, you do have the primary and the secondary headset scenario. Coming to the second part of it is some amount of power conservation and latency improvement can be achieved by optimizing the codec. So the joint stereo decoding and encoding is very popular for traditional A2DP from the phones. But you really don't have to transmit stereo encoded audio channels between the primary and the secondary earbud. So this requires some amount of customization where you only send one encoded channel and that helps you, and that when it gets decoded would actually help you with your latency as well. So these are a couple of key customizations we see. Again, we're not getting into details of how these are implemented because that would, there are many ways to implement these features and would often proprietary to our customers. Second, I think, is the most trickier part of TW's implementation is the synchronization between the left and the right earbuds. So we see our customers asking for anywhere from 10 microseconds to 20 microseconds for the purposes of synchronization. And again, this also has multiple methods for you to achieve the synchronization. So we know of certain methodologies where you have a custom implementation of a clock, which comes from the hardware, which is used. But in Mindtree, we use the concept of a Bluetooth piconet, which allows two devices to actually share a synchronized clock. And using this approach, the two earbuds will be on the same clock. And then you then rely on the Bluetooth back channel to transmit information on specific audio packets, and the timing for it to start playing with respect to the synchronization of the piconet clock. And apart from this, this synchronization algorithm would be running on the background and making sure that all the audio frames are synchronized based on the messages which are received by the secondary earbud from the primary earbud. So using this approach, we have achieved in the range around 20 microseconds of synchronization. And again, this is something which we have achieved without any customization required from the hardware side. going on to how it is getting implemented on low energy. On Bluetooth low energy, I think Anindya already introduced the concept of synchronous streams of audio. Now, this is what is going to get used for the purpose of TWS implementation in LE audio. So you have something called as a connected isochronous group, or the CIG, and all the streams which are a part of the CIG are all synchronized to the same clock. And the way Bluetooth low energy audio works is that there is the CIG events, right? And so when the CIG events are being transmitted from the source to multiple sync devices, it also transmits a delay time, or the delay at point of which this particular event needs to get triggered and the audio needs to be played. And this concept is used to make sure that your audio is always synchronized to start at the same instant of time based on the common clock you have between the two streams. And just to make sure that the bandwidth is optimized, these CIG events can be overlapping, something like a pipeline stage where you can load multiple events all set to trigger at various time sequences. And you get to get you get to see good implementations of TWS without too much of customization required, as we did with Classic. So that said, I think it's not going to be so easy to just transition out of Bluetooth Classic to go into dual mode. Our experience so far and working with customers is that Classic is not really going anywhere. Pretty much everybody seems to be looking at a real dual mode implementation, which includes both Classic and low energy. And that kind of leads us into the key question on, is LE going to replace Classic audio? And to answer that, I think we have to go back to Chuck, who's our expert in the market.
So thank you, Johnny. You know, one of the key or frequently asked questions we get is LE audio going to replace Classic audio? And I think really the answer here is it depends. It depends on your timeline, it depends on your product cycle, and it depends on your product, your initial use cases. But to really answer the question, I think there is a bit of context that we need to place around the audio market and the specification that's important. Next slide. So one of the reasons for the 20 years of success that Bluetooth has had in audio is, and the ability to reach that 1.5 billion devices shipping each and every year, is that the community has continued to innovate and evolve the wireless audio functionality inside Bluetooth. And if you look at the evolution of the use cases alone, you know, we started with hands-free calling, added the ability to do stereo listening, I provided the ability to synchronize audio and video for wireless watching experiences. And more recently, with the rise of voice assistants like Alexa and Google Assistants and Siri and so on, you know, additional functionality has been augmented and added into the specification over time. Next slide. But what's been really clear is over the last couple of years that developers have really had to stretch the Bluetooth audio from a Classic implementation to its limits. Developers have had to do a number of what we would consider more proprietary extensions to the technology in order to satisfy some of these more recent use cases. So next slide. So that said, there are three guiding principles that really lend a hand in helping us answer this question as to whether or not LE audio will replace Classic audio. The first guiding principle for LE audio is that it must help to improve the performance of the existing use cases. And what this means is that it must be able to make so that we can make sure that we continue to allow the products to satisfy the current use cases and device types that consumers know and love today. Next slide. And second is that LE Audio must standardize support for many of these recent member-specific innovations that have been made to the audio streaming experience. And this means adding explicit, as we talked about earlier, explicit and standardized support for devices like hearing aids and TWS and voice control and multi-source use cases and so on that have been extended onto the existing audio capabilities. Next slide. And last, LE Audio must add the flexibility to be easily enable future innovation. And this means putting the infrastructure in place and the platforms in place to enable the future of the next 20 years for wireless audio innovation. And keeping all three of these principles in mind, depending on the use case, your product cycle, and market demands, it may take some time for all use cases and all devices to ultimately move over to LE Audio. However, when we are launching something that's new generation, next generation like this, there is a certain expectation or predictions that we can make about what to expect in the market as we transition from one form of the technology to another form of the technology. So why don't we go to the next slide. So we don't know exactly how this is going to happen or under what type of time frame. However, we do have a what we would consider a very relevant example or proxy from the past evolution of Bluetooth technology. And that was ultimately the introduction of the Bluetooth low energy radio in general, not just the audio part, but the Bluetooth low energy radio in general, displacing many of the use cases associated with Bluetooth Classic. In this case, it is a very interesting proxy, because we anticipate as a market or the device transition to be similar to the diagram that you see here on the left-hand side. You know, when we launched LE Audio, or the LE Radio, Bluetooth Classic only implementations, they did start to slow down. But it was actually picked up and even grew further and faster with dual mode implementations. And what we saw was dual mode implementations supporting both LE radios as well as the classic radio implementations. And these were mostly in the platforms, the phones, the tablets, the PCs, you know, those elements that were necessary in order to enable this new type, these new device types that were going to be enabled through the LE radio. And we see this happening early with the audio source devices as well, phones, tablets, and PCs, and other audio sources that are designed ultimately to support both the legacy devices and new innovative devices that are going to be using LE audio only. So at the same time, we'll see innovative sync devices and solutions like hearing aids and audio sharing coming to market as LE audio only type devices. And if you think back again to the LE radio analogy, we saw this with devices like wearables and sensors and other devices that quickly came up in the market as LE only devices to take advantage of the power management and the application flexibility that the LE radio was bringing to the market. So again, we see this same and very similar curve to be the prediction of where we're going to see LE audio, to the point that classic only will continue to fade slowly as device cycles and innovation in a variety of audio markets ultimately catches up and brings the innovation of LE audio to the market. So again, will LE audio replace classic audio? Well, it depends. It depends on your device type. It depends on your time horizon, it depends on your scope, and so on. But we do see a very similar proxy to what we saw in the LE audio in terms of predictions of, or in the LE radio, to see as a prediction for what we're gonna see in LE audio for the future.
I think that's pretty much what we had, Sarah. I think we can move to the questions now.
Great, thanks, Rajni. Let's open it up for audience questions. I see a few questions have come in, but I just want to remind everyone to type your questions into the question box located on your webinar control panel. Any questions we don't get to will be answered via email after the event. Okay, so we do have a number of questions. Our first one comes from Antonio. And the question is it better to use multicast for TWS?
So for the, I assume that the question is from the Bluetooth low energy point of view. And for those typical scenarios, the CIS, as we talked about, the connection-oriented one will be more reliable, and you want to have a better audio experience there. So it will be mostly the CIS and the CIG, as it's called. The grouping of that, which is synchronized, will be the most commonly used. But then there could be scenarios where the TV or someone is basically listening, multiple users are listening from there, and it is broadcasting some of those channels. So in that, those use cases, you will have the broadcast as well as the grouped broadcast kind of a scenario. But if it is specifically the TWS use cases, it will be connection oriented, CIS and CIG typically with the Bluetooth Low Energy.
Thank you. Our next question is directed at Chuck, and it comes from Krishna. Is Bluetooth SIG going to provide reference code and test vectors apart from the specification for LC3 codec?
Well, Bluetooth provides tested with every specification that the Bluetooth SIG provides. We also provide a corresponding test specification for qualification purposes. So if the context of the question is, will we have a test specification to match against the actual LC3 specification, the answer to that question is yes. That is a common practice from the Bluetooth SIG, and both of those come together. There is no delay between the specification and the test specification coming out. They both come out at the same time.
Okay, great. Our next question comes from Ryan, and it's, I understand that channels can be synchronized at the packet level, but will they also be synchronized at the sample clock level?
Yes, that's the idea. So if you see in the classic Bluetooth also, it is not a very different kind of a concept. In the 3D glass scenario, which is there in the classic Bluetooth today, also works in a very similar kind of a concept. So as Rajni was actually explaining, so you will have that the source device, when it's transmitting the connection-oriented channel, the synchronous audio, it is going to tell at what delay from the piconet clock that need to be played out, so that synchronization delay will help the sync 1, sync 2, and sync 3 to play it out at the same time. So the concept of the Bluetooth clock is there, and that is inbuilt as part of the specification itself. When you are talking about the grouping of CIS with CIG, this particular concept is part of the already adopted spec.
Okay, great. Our next question comes from Christian. How complex is the LC3 codec? Is a DSP needed, or would it also run on a simple MCU?
Good question, expecting this one. Yeah, so it is difficult to compare as such. Definitely, I can tell you that while it is giving, as we saw, the bandwidth requirement, like we compared with the music audio at 48 kilohertz from 160 kbps and 345 of SBC. Similarly, if we compare, let's say, the mono audio, there also like with the 24 or 30 kbps, you will get a very similar kind of a compression that you get with the MSBC kind of a thing. So it's like giving at least half of the or double the compression what we get with SBC. But it is definitely computationally a little more complex than SBC. But it is still in early stage. Yes, it is possible definitely to run in an MCU, the ARM and the other such processors. But some of the blocks, as you understand, that it has, it is also part of the LC3 plus, and that is already adopted, so I can talk about that. You have this MDCT or cosine transformation, which is there, or the inverse transformation, and there is some arithmetic encoder or decoder which happens, which takes the majority of part of it. So you will see some places those things get offloaded as part of the controller itself is doing as a hardware accelerator and all. Or you will have a DSP in the beginning. And then also, as you know, that okay, when you're talking about SBC, like 20 years back, and the kind of ARM processors that we have, currently you have a much more advanced processors and have a very advanced, I would say, the instruction sets which can operate on vectors, can actually work on the floating point numbers itself. We do not have need really for an embedded system, a fixed point thing. So there are a lot of possibilities and people are trying it out, but optimization is currently in progress. So yes, you will have a mix of all of them to start with. DSP, it is possible to run on the MCU as well, and you will have something which is running in the hardware accelerator and also in the MCU.
Just one thing I would like to add is just that, so we at Mindtree have, based on the draft spec, we started working on this. We have got to a pretty advanced stage. So we will be able to, we do see it working on an embedded system, on an ARM-based core.
Yeah, absolutely. And the Cortex-M4 or stuff like that, it will be really hard to run it on the Cortex-M0 and all, you know, that if it does not support a lot of DSP instructions and all of them. But Cortex-M3, M4 onwards, it should be possible to run it.
Very good. And I think our next question is for Chuck, and it's come from a couple of different people asking if Bluetooth SIG will share the reference code for LC3.
Well, I guess it's a good question. What we share is the specification for LC3 use in the context of Bluetooth. So I'm not sure if that is decided yet. That's something I'd have to go back and check and see what I can't answer that question at this point in time.
Gotcha.
Can I add that if you come to Mindtree, we will give you the source code. You just have to license it from us.
I think we've got time for just one more question before we wrap it up. And this one comes from Kunal. What are the major limitations over LE audio right now? What's the plan to overcome them?
Sorry, can you repeat the question? Sorry about that.
Yeah, I think got it. Like, what are the limitations on the LE audio and how we can overcome some of those? Obviously, as you see, right, the Bluetooth itself, although there's an improvement, but then the good part of the Bluetooth as such is that as a technology, there are a lot of companies get involved in the early stages and then try to find out whether the way the technology is evolving is going to address the kind of use case they have or those industry have. So on that light, obviously there are the LE audio has made good stride, but also at the same time, because after the 5.02 got adopted and we are working currently, the Bluetooth SIG is working currently on the LE profiles. There are a few things which we cannot actually discuss in the specifics of that, but there are improvements areas continuously is getting defined, which are good to have as we talked about, let's say the hearing aid or let's say the TWS are talking about. Although the Bluetooth Low Energy makes it much better than the classic Bluetooth, but then there's no limit to it, right? You want to save, let's say you're sending 4 messages, you want to send 2 of them, and you save half of your battery life. You want to, you are getting maybe 2.5 seconds of algorithmic delay somehow, you want to reduce it to tends to zero, right? You reduce it as much as possible. So all of these basically, again, like from the specification point of view, which is going on. And the other good part is we cannot actually describe right now how the spec is getting defined, but it is exactly like the microservice kind of a thing. So a lot of these blocks, whatever we had, because in the classic Bluetooth, we saw that for the audio, we had A2DP, AVRCP, and HFP. But here you will see a whole bunch of things which is coming up so that it becomes more easily. It's like a block kind of thing. You can take many of them and it is going to be easier. But again, there will be a lot of improvements when it comes and you'll have a different version of it. So yes, this is the start of it, but we have seen like in the Bluetooth 4.0, the power consumption reduced significantly. But if you see from that to 4.2 and 5.0, with the DLE and bringing up the 2 megabits per second kind of a thing, that to send out the same amount of data today, it requires a very significant amount of reduced power, maybe 80%, 60% kind of thing. So you will see continuously the improvement and the way the audio comes over LE. It is in the market. There'll be more. I won't be surprised that we would have missed out while defining the specifications and which will come out the real scenarios and those holes will be patched or like those workarounds or those improvements will basically happen going forward. So yes, it is good, but definitely is not perfect.
Hey, can I just interject very quickly back on the previous question just for clarity with regards to the LC3 codec? I just want to make sure I'm clear that the LC3 codec is part of the royalty-free licensing of the Bluetooth specification for companies that qualify their implementations. There is no additional royalty fee associated with the LC3 codec for Bluetooth as defined through the Bluetooth specification. So I just wanted to make sure I was clear on that particular aspect in terms of what we will be providing from the Bluetooth SIG.
Great, thank you, Chuck. So that's all the time we have for today. If you're interested in learning more about our Bluetooth solutions, our team is ready to help. please reach out to us at info@mindtree.com. I'd like to thank our speakers, Rajni, Anindya, Chuck, and a special thanks to you, our audience, for spending the last hour with us. Please check our Mindtree events webpage and social channels for a list of upcoming virtual events. Lastly, we'd really appreciate it if you would take a short survey immediately following this session. A window will appear when this webinar ends. Thanks again, have a great day, and we hope to see you at another event soon.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you.